And Father, we thank you. And we do praise you. And we ascribe to your name greatness and wonder and power and strength. And we stand in awe of you. And we thank you this morning that we can be here to hear your word. We pray that your spirit will reign in this place, that hearts will be opened and be changed, and that you will be glorified. We thank you in Jesus' name, amen.
Well, if you can, turn your Bibles to 2 Peter, or 1 Peter chapter 2, and then we're going to be looking almost immediately back in the book of Exodus, chapter 19. But as you guys are turning there, about 10 years ago, I received a call late at night on a Friday night, I think it was, from a middle-aged lady in the congregation. She had a 20-something-year-old son who had been struggling for a long time with life choices, with chemical addictions, so that would have been drug and alcohol. And he had been in and out of jail, a brief stint in prison, actually, about 25, 26 years old. Knew him really well, had gotten to be able to come alongside of him, and we had kind of started a friendship. But he was still struggling spiritually quite a bit. So she calls me in a panic late on Friday night. He was out. She suspected that he was probably high on drugs somewhere, and she was desperate to find him. She had been driving around much of that evening and found his vehicle outside of an establishment up in northern Michigan, which was sort of this bar clubhouse. It had the reputation of being the place where a lot of criminal activity went on. I actually got to know the owner from another encounter, another situation quite well. We had lunch a couple of times. But it was a place of ill repute, to be sure. And so she calls me. She's panicked. It's not a place that you can just kind of walk into. And so I hop in the car and I go down and I go walking up, and I think now we're probably 11 o'clock, maybe midnight, and kind of beat on this big steel door. So imagine this scene. It's this big, huge old house. It's probably just over 100 years old. I have been added on to, and none of it was probably up to building code. And they boarded all of the windows. They put a big, huge steel door in, so you can't see in, you can't see out. It's just one of those places that you got to knock on the door. They open up a slot. They decide if they're going to let you in or not. Not because it's like this elitist place, but more it's like the opposite socioeconomically. And so I beat on the door, and they open it up, and they let me in. And I go walking in, and they close the door behind me and deadbolt it behind me. So you don't go in without their permission. You don't leave without their permission. It's just that kind of an establishment. So I asked for this young guy. They know where he is. There's an upstairs portion to this place, and there's some rooms and stuff that are there. So I go walking up this staircase, and in some of those older houses now turned into sort of a weird establishment. Remember how steep those staircases are, or they used to make them? Really narrow. I could probably, just with a little bit of expansion, touch both walls in the hallway with my elbow, just really tight, really narrow going up. I go up and I go into a couple of rooms. He's not there. Finally get into like the third or fourth room, which is awkward, kind of peeking your head in those rooms. And I see him and he's passed out. He had been using some substances that evening, and he's just passed out on the couch or sofa or whatever it was that was there. Big guy. Try to get him up. Try to get him walking. He's not walking. Try to get him up on my shoulders. That's just sort of a no-go. I call another gentleman from the church, dear friend, to this day a dear friend, and he gave me a disappointing answer. I told him what was going on. I told him the situation. I needed some physical assistance to get this guy out, and he had told me that when I told him where I was, he said, "Pastor, I can't go there. That'll hurt my reputation for Christ if I go to that place." Okay, all right. So I just go to the next person on my list on my phone, right? And I finally get a hold of another guy in the church. I'll be right there. And this is where the story gets really interesting. So he comes in. I have to go down and convince these guys to let him in. So he comes in. We go upstairs. There's that long and arduous process of getting this guy down the stairs and into the vehicle. He throws up on us as we're doing that. So I'm outside trying to clean this whole situation up, trying to decide, is it a medical situation? Do we take him to the hospital or not? As I'm working on cleaning this up, I turn around and the the guy that had come to assist, I can't find him, but his vehicle's still there. So I look all around the property, go around back, kind of walk up and down the road a little bit. He's nowhere to be found, so I think, he couldn't have went back inside. But I go and I beat on the steel door again, and they let me back in. And here is this guy from the church sitting up at the corner of the bar praying with one of the patrons who's there. He'd went back inside and was just talking about Jesus with people. Sharing Jesus with people. And he told me later that some of the people just kind of rebuffed it and some people made fun of it. But one guy there was this connection with, and that short span of time, he had shared his faith. He had been praying with this individual, and we ended up taking two guys home that night. And I share that story for this, because you had three Christian men who had three different responses to that situation. One was, I'm not touching it. My personal holiness, my personal reputation, I'm going to kind of stay away, right? And I struggle with that approach sometimes. I think if you're doing something because you want to avoid a temptation yourself, I think that's perfectly acceptable. In his case, that's probably wasn't as the reason. You had another guy, in that case it would be me, who was trying to do something that was good, right? Responding. And actually I'm thinking during that time period, hey, Jesus went out and he went after the lost sheep. And so that's kind of what I'm doing. I mean, that metaphor is in my head as I'm there, but I'm like zeroed in on this one task of getting this guy physically out of a building and getting him home to his parents' place, getting him so he's a little bit safer, maybe being able to have a conversation with him regarding his choices and where he's at with God. But that's it. That's all I was there to do. I came in, I went in, and really didn't talk to anybody else other than to find out where he was. And then you had third guy. Third guy is there to do everything that I was there to do, but he had something inside of him. We've been talking about spiritual gifts, but let's just use the term desire. I think it is a gift, but he had this burning passion inside of his soul. He was wired in such a way, and he had developed a desire to such a degree in his life that sharing his faith with others was just who he was. He had to do it. I'll be honest with you. When I finally get, I was irritated when I couldn't find him. I go back inside because I'm thinking, I mean, it's like now almost 2 o'clock in the morning. I am tired. I have a human being's puke on me. It's not even my kid. So that's like the bad kind, right? And I'm just angry at that point in time. And I go in and I see him praying with this individual and talk about this rebuking message from the Holy Spirit that came over me. I was there to do a good thing, but yet there still was this better thing right in front of me that I missed, right? This better thing in front of me that I missed. There are people that God has so uniquely gifted with, and we're looking at evangelism, the gift of evangelism. We're looking at the gift of missions this morning. There are people who are so uniquely gifted that this is their burning passion. This is their desire. And they are in the church for two primary reasons. One, to ensure that the gospel is proclaimed, that lost people come in contact with the basic message of Jesus through their own personal activity. And then two, to spur on, to encourage, to promote among all believers that same kind of activity, right? They are there almost like our conscience. They're reminding us all the time of this big mission that God has called all of us into. So if you're in your Bibles, in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. And so Peter writes this to the group of people that he is writing to. He says, but you. Now, the you there is plural, and he's not saying you who have the gift of evangelism in that particular local congregation, or you who have the gift, we're going to be talking about the gift of missions in a second. He's not talking to the subset of believers in a particular local congregation who happen to be really gifted and passionate about sharing their faith. He's talking to all of them. And by extension, he's talking to all of us. If you are a follower of Jesus, if you love Jesus, right? He is talking to you. He is talking to me when he says this. You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are a people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. So he says, listen, this is who you are. You're a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. You are a people belonging to God. Now, I think the implication of that would have already been clear, but then he pushes it even further and makes it even more clear when he adds this statement, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light. In other words, guys, not only have we've been saved for a reason. We've been saved for a purpose. There's an activity that's to be done now. There's a basic motivation that we're supposed to have. And if we don't have it, then we're supposed to try to develop that basic motivation in our life. And the cool part about this, this is nothing new. This is not inherently a New Testament idea. This is God who has always had the same purpose all the way through human history. And to demonstrate that, I want us to look back in Exodus chapter 19. Exodus 19. He says, we'll begin in verse 5. He says this, now if you obey me fully and keep my covenant. So God speaking to Moses, and then Moses is supposed to give this message to the people, right? Now if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations, you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine. Now get that. Get that power that's behind that statement. Get that declaration of sovereignty that's behind that statement, right? Although the entire earth is mine, you will be for me. That you is plural. So he's talking to the nation of Israel here to Moses, but again, he wants this message passed on. You will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. So Peter essentially is alluding to or quoting from Exodus 19 when he makes his statement in the New Testament, right? Here he says, you will be a kingdom of priests, a holy nation. And then he adds this to Moses, these are the words you are to speak to the Israelites. In other words, you better pass on my message, right? This is so important, Moses, that they need to hear it. You need to teach this to them. You need to ensure that they hear with their ears, right? They read with their eyes, right? This is why Moses later on records all of these things and gives these documents, the first five books of the Bible, to the people of Israel. You're going to ensure that they hear and know and memorize and understand this message, because not only do I love my people, not only do I have a plan for my people, I have a purpose for my people, right? So you have this language of this kingdom of priests, this holy nation. Peter picks up the priest idea again, this group of priests, this nation of priests in 1 Peter chapter 2, and those two ideas together. So what's being said here, right? Peter makes it more explicit. The New Testament usually does. You know, the Old Testament is a lot of its story or its poetry, and the New Testament tends to just kind of come out and say something. And so what's taking place here? This priest idea is this. A priest, by definition, is an individual who mediates. He mediates between the divine and humanity, right? So we see pagan versions of this all the time, right? With the various cults of the old pagan religions. And so you had this priest who kind of mediates between the two, and you take your offerings to the priest, and the priest does a prayer, or he blesses, or whatever it might be. There was a biblical version of that in the Old Testament as well. So the Jewish people would bring their sacrifices, and you needed a priest. A priest had to be there, right? So you take your offerings to the priest, and he performs a sacrifice on your behalf. So the priest was this sort of intercessory individual. He takes the prayers of the people, the sacrifices of the people, the worship of the people, and he presents those before the Lord. And then there was this vice versa role that was there, that he takes the messages of the Lord, particularly when you bring in the Old Testament prophetic idea into that equation, and he then communicates those messages to the people. Now, why don't we have priests in our church today? Because because of 1 Peter chapter 2, because we are a kingdom of priests. By the way, the New Testament makes clear that although that mediator idea of the priesthood was important in the Old Testament, there is now one mediator between God and man, and that's the person Christ Jesus, right? And so I'm your pastor. I am in no sense your priest. I am one, as are you, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, right? And so this idea of a priest, but we still have this priestly role. And so what does a priest do? A priest represents God. To who? To humanity. You are just as much priest as I am, male and female, right? Young kid who's accepted Jesus, if you're 7 years old and you've given your life to Jesus, you are as much a priest of the living God as the 88-year-old who has been walking with Christ for decades. Right? So there's this role that we have as believers, that we get this role, we get this exciting duty, we get this awesome privilege and blessing that we represent God. We speak God's truth, we represent His presence, and we do become the voice and the face of God for every single non-believer with whom we interact. And so in the book of Exodus, we see the seedbed of this idea of evangelism or representation or taking God's message, God's truth, the awareness of God's presence with us wherever we go. So Peter simply picks up on a very old and ancient idea, and he's putting his finger on this mandate that God has had for his people for thousands of years, right? Now we've added a few thousand more onto that since the time that Peter wrote his document. In other words, let me just simplify all that by saying this. Evangelism and missions has always been the heartbeat of our God. It's always been the heartbeat of our God. It's not a New Testament idea. I love the New Testament. I'm a New Testament guy. This is a New Testament church. Yay, New Testament. But that particular idea is a long-standing biblical idea that we see all the way back in the earliest books of the Bible, that God's people have been called by His name, right? To Him, to have a relationship with Him in order to represent Him and declare His worth to everybody else. Now, what does seem to be new, okay, or at least it's more specified and more described in the New Testament, is God very clearly and intentionally and systematically has given within the local churches individuals who just have this supernatural empowerment and this like bigger than like anybody else around them desire to share their faith, right? They're kind of like the gospel cheerleaders. They're getting us all kind of back into the game. I mean, I love watching sports. I do watch professional sports, depending on the sport. I like college a lot more. I like watching that a lot more than I like watching professional stuff. And I actually love watching local sports, high school sports, far more than I like watching college sports. There's just something kind of tangible about going to like a high school basketball game or a soccer game or a volleyball game. And the cheerleaders, those sports that actually still have cheerleaders. I love that because you get a crowd that gets distracted. A crowd has a personality. And sometimes they're really into the game, and sometimes they're kind of checked out of the game, and sometimes their heart is kind of broken by what they see going on the floor, or they're distracted by, or they're being overshadowed by the crowd from the opposing team. I mean, you got all those dynamics taking place. Maybe the snacks are really good at the snack shop, and they're just all focused on that. Whatever it might be, the cheerleaders have one basic job: to get the crowd back into the game, right? They get their mind focused on the game. They get them cheering for the game. That's their job, right? And they just come running out into the floor. They get like a 30 second, if it's basketball, they got 30 seconds because there's a timeout being called, and they're out there on the floor trying to get the crowd on their feet, excited and going. That's the individuals with the gift of missions and evangelism, at least one of their roles. is to continually call us as a church body, every single local church, back to our basic mission. So if you have the insert and you're a note-taking person, evangelism, the gift of evangelism is the passion to share the gospel everywhere, okay? So how do you know you have the gift of evangelism? You are sharing the gospel like everywhere you go, right? That, or at least you have that desire to, because I think we need to grow in some of these gifts that we've been given as well. But you got that passion, you got that thought process. People don't have to remind you to share your faith. You just naturally think of that. Now, maybe you're still developing the boldness to actually execute that, but when you're in these kind of environments, or really any environment, you're thinking, man, I want to share my faith with this individual. So evangelism is the passion to share the gospel everywhere. Missions is the ability to effectively share that gospel abroad, right? So they're related. They're two related ideas. They both have the same heartbeat. They both have the same motivation. They both have the same passion. They both have the same activity, right? Content. The only difference is really location at that point in time. Evangelism is anywhere he or she is. The missions individual, we're going to get into what that missions gift means specifically in a second, is the individual who's just been uniquely gifted to be picked up from his or her sort of socioeconomic context and go into a completely different culture, whether that's Arizona, right, or a retirement community in Florida, or whether that's the hills of Kentucky, or it's over in the flats of Bangladesh. I mean, it's almost irrelevant where they go, but they have the ability to pick up, leave their cultural context, and fit in effectively and be able to share their faith effectively where they're going. Let's break this down a little bit. The word evangelism never actually appears anywhere in the New Testament, or the Bible for that matter. In fact, the word evangelism didn't even appear in the English language until the 17th century. And that's because there was a lot of revival movements that were beginning to happen, particularly in England. Those revival movements eventually came to the United States. And in that flurry of evangelistic gospel sharing, witnessing to others about Jesus' activity, they coined the term evangelism to be able to kind of figure, you know, just to refer to what was happening. It's a good word. I like the word. It's an invented word, but it's a very, very good word that kind of brings us back to what our basic idea is. But the word evangelist does appear. We see that word three times. In one case, you have an individual who's specifically called an evangelist. That'd be Philip. Acts 6, 7, 8, those chapters, particularly Acts 8, really describes his activity. And then in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, you have there Paul having a conversation about spiritual gifts, and he refers to evangelists, plural, that one of the spiritual gifts is being an evangelist. And there's a little bit of a debate, if you guys read up on the spiritual gift stuff, that I think is probably a silly debate, but you get online, you do a Google search on the spiritual gift of evangelism, and there's like all of these blogs and articles, and even some scholarly articles that are arguing about there's no such thing as the gift of evangelism because that word doesn't appear to the 17th century, but there's the gift of being an evangelist. I think that's probably a distinction without a difference. An evangelist is one who engages in evangelism. If you are engaging in evangelism, then you are an evangelist. I don't think we got to split the hairs on those terms. They all refer to the same idea. So the evangelist is the individual who is so excited about the message of Jesus that he or she just continually shares their faith or has that desire. The gift of missions, we need to break this one down a little bit. Because like evangelism, we don't really see the word missions in the Bible. And the closest that you really come to it is the chapter headings, which really aren't even biblical. The chapter headings that the editors put in when they print the Bibles, the great commission, you kind of have mission kind of hidden into that word. But it's a word that literally means envoy or messenger. And we normally translate that word apostle, or we often translate that word apostle. The apostolos were the envoys. They were the ambassadors. They were the messengers. An apostolos was an individual who, a sovereign, usually a king, or maybe a governor or a regional authority of some kind, would then give that individual a message. They're more than runners, right? It's not like they're you got a scroll and they put their wax and their stamp on it and you just take that message and you hand it off. It's more than that. You become an official representative. Your voice is what's heard, but it's the other guy's message. That's the ambassador, right? And we know what the ambassador concept, we have those things because Donald Trump's been in trouble for talking to a few of them. So you have those things that are happening, right? And you think some of this stuff is like, this is common. So you have the ambassador of Canada and the ambassador of Russia and the ambassador of Iceland and the ambassador of who knows where else. Their job is to talk to our people. And we have ambassadors that we send all over the place to do the same thing, right? So this stuff makes sense. We know these ideas. What we don't sometimes understand is that in one sense, that's all of our jobs. That's all of our jobs as believers. And in another sense, God gave certain individuals, in the case of the New Testament, the 12 apostles, and then we can add Paul into that equation, and then of course they replaced Judas as well, so there was a few more than 12, individuals who were given a very special authority as apostles. But there are other individuals in the New Testament who use that word, and they were able to make a distinction in the New Testament time between the apostles, in other words, the guys who had sort of the authority to lay the foundation of biblical truth for the church, and the other apostles. We might today say apostles with a capital A versus apostles with a small case A, if you want to use that distinction. For example, in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, we have one particular individual who's sent out by the Philippian church as an apostolos. We would probably be better served, instead of translating that apostle, to say missionary, right? And some versions actually use a different word other than apostle to avoid confusion. And so they use that same word, but they were able to understand that word meant slightly different things in different contexts. When you refer to Peter as an apostolos or Paul as an apostolos, everyone in the New Testament church understood there was an authority thing that was there, unlike other people. But when you used it for the guy in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, for example, no one assumed that he had Paul's or Peter's authority. But what everyone understood by that term is a local church, what they do, by the nature of who they are. They identify, they train, equip, and send envoys, ambassadors, people who speak somebody else's message. And in this case, it's not our message that's being spoken. It's a message that was already given to us. It's the message of Christ. It's the message of the gospel. It's the message that comes from the triune throne of our God. And so we identify, we train, we equip, then we send out these apostoloses, right? These individuals who have this gift of missions. What drives these people? Those with these gifts desire to see the church expand through the salvation of the lost. And that's at the end of the day, at the beginning of the day, at the middle of the day. I mean, this is the thing that motivates mission people and evangelism people. They want to see the church grow. Not just this church, but they want to see the church grow. They want to see the church grow, but they don't simply want, in our context, it'd be Cascades Baptist. They don't simply want Cascades Baptist to go from 300 to 500 to 600 to 700. That's not enough for them, right? They want to see it specifically grow through lost people coming to a saving knowledge in Jesus. I mean, I think everyone's happy when people move in or for whatever reason decide to come to a church. We all like that idea, but that doesn't excite evangelism people. That doesn't excite mission people. They just see that sort of lateral transfer taking place, and if anything, they get slightly annoyed by that. They want to see the church grow. They want to see the church expand through the salvation of lost, a non-believer coming to faith in Jesus and recognizing their need for him and crying out to Jesus to be Lord and Savior. They want to see that happen, right? They want to see that happen over and over and over again. It's never enough for them. And it's never supposed to be enough for them, right? I mean, this is the mission until Christ returns. This is the mission for all of us. And so what benefit do they bring to us? How about this? Look, turn your Bibles to 3 John chapter 7. 3 John. 3 John is kind of hidden. If you find Revelation, the very last book, just flip back two very short books. You got Jude, small little one-page thing, and then you got 3 John, even smaller. So 3 John, only one chapter. So 3 John, verse 7. Okay? Well, let's start in verse 6. They have told the truth. They have told the church about your love. Who are these people? Verse 5. Dear friends, you are faithful in what you are doing for the brothers, even though they are strangers to you. So the context there, these brothers, these traveling individuals who are going out and doing ministry, right? So they've given up home, job, career, potentially even family, at least extended family, and they've been sent out is sort of the idea of the context. These brothers who are strangers to you. So he's writing to a specific congregation, talking about Christian brothers, spiritual siblings in the Lord who are out there traveling, and this local congregation has come into contact with them. Okay, so they have told the church about your love. You will do well to send them on their way in a manner worthy of God. It was for the sake of the name that they went out, receiving no help from the pagans. So there's a couple of things happening there. One, there is this call for us to financially bless and to financially support those who are going out. We would use the term missionary, those who are going out for the sake of the name, the ambassadors, the envoys, the messengers, right? But there's something else that we don't want to miss. It says in verse 7 specifically, they went out for the sake of the name. They were so excited. That name, of course, refers to the name above all names, which is Jesus. They're so excited about the message and the person of Jesus, they can't stop telling others about his name, who he is, mentioning his name in conversations. He just comes up over and over. They're that excited about Jesus. And so the people with this gift, the evangelist among us, the missionaries, the budding missionaries, or the mission-minded people. I don't know if everyone who has the gift of missions is on the mission field. You have just some logistical things happening sometimes. You have medical things that happen. You have a lot of things that can happen. But you have mission-minded people and evangelism-minded people, and they remind us as a church body to be excited about Jesus. To be excited about Jesus. I love it when I'm with another believer who brings up Jesus in their conversation repeatedly, right? It reminds me to be more excited about you. I walk away blessed by that encounter. Hopefully I can bless others with that same thing when I bring up Jesus to you. And there's people in the church who just have that gift. Everything comes back to who Jesus is. And it is a fantastic gift. And they remind us to be excited about the name, to bring them up in our conversations, to be intentional. But more than just an intentionality, because I think that's where it begins for a lot of us. If you don't happen to have those gifts, it begins with you sort of making the decision to be intentional and maybe even to hold yourself accountable. Maybe write out a chart at the end of the day. You laying in bed and you say, okay, have I talked about Jesus with somebody today? Yes, no, no, okay. So tomorrow, renewed commitment, and I need to be intentional. So I think that's where it begins, but where it has to go to is that this becomes just so natural for us because we've been so intentional to bring up the name of Jesus. We've developed this pattern, and we are just excited about Jesus, and then no one can stop us, right? We just keep talking about Jesus. So those with this gift just bring everything back to the name. And they remind us to be excited, to be passionate. Turn to Mark 16, 15. This is Mark's version. You guys know the Great Commission, which we usually go to Matthew 18 for that one, or 28 for that one. But Mark 16 is Mark's version of that. And he says this, and I like Mark. Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew is heavy on Jesus' teachings, right? Just a lot of teachings of Jesus in Matthew. Luke has been called for centuries the historian for good reason. He gives us a lot of data. In fact, a lot of people, when they're trying to retrace the timeline of Jesus, it can be kind of hard when you're trying to compare the various gospel accounts sometimes. A lot of scholars use Luke as the baseline for chronology because he just was very kind of data-minded, historically minded, accuracy-minded in terms of sequences and events and everything. John is like this bird's eye view. It's the most theological. It's the most sovereignly focused. It's the most worshipful, probably, of the four Gospels. The reason I like Mark is Mark's like this scrappy fighter personality. He's not the most educated among of Jesus' followers, right? And then that comes through in the writing style. The Greek is choppy, it's simplistic, it's naive, almost uneducated, right? It's terse, gets right to the point. He doesn't clean anything up, he doesn't make anything look pretty, he just says stuff, right? So that's Mark, that's his gospel. It's short, it's punchy, it's to the point. And so there's not this long, kind of drawn out, flowery speech about what our job is supposed to be. He simply records this. Jesus said to them, or he said to them, go into all the world and preach the good news to all creation. Boom, period, done, right? Simple as that. That's our job, to go into all the world and to preach the gospel of Jesus. And evangelism people and mission people keep us focused on our mission. Over and over and over, they keep us focused on our mission. A church that either doesn't have the evangelism-minded or the mission-minded, or the church that has ceased listening to them, is a church that becomes cold and dead. It's the church that does activity and busyness incredibly well, but they've stepped away from the very heartbeat of the living God. And this, the heartbeat of God, is where spiritual life and vitality is always found, right? We step away from that, and eventually something cold begins to grip. We're off focus, we're off mission, right? If a church does that. And so the evangelism people keep us focused all the time. These are the individuals when there's a meeting about something, right? An activity or a new program or a curriculum or whatever else. They just want to be, you need to show me how this helps a non-believer come to Jesus. You need to show me how it does that, right? So the individuals who are kind of holding everybody's feet to the fire. And the last thing is this, and I want you to see this with your own eyes. So turn to Psalms 96, if you would. You can take my word for it, but this is biblical truth we're talking about. Psalm 96, verse 3. Let's start up in verse 1, maybe to get a little bit of context. Psalm 96 says this, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, praise his name. Proclaim his salvation day after day. So context here is not a worship service. Okay, I want to be clear about that. It includes a worship service. Because if you just say, well, it says sing, and we sing in worship, well, yes, it includes a worship service. But notice what it says at the very end of verse 2. Proclaim his salvation day after day. This is a continual thing. This is like an all-day activity thing, and you get up the next morning, and you do it all over again. You get up the next morning, and you do it all over again. So it includes what we did earlier in the hour when we corporately sang in worship of our God together. It includes that idea, but the concept being discussed here, in fact, in most worship passages in the Bible, is that idea, that desire, that passion, that activity, that framework from which we approach life goes out with us after the worship service, and we engage in the same God-declaring activity as we were doing when we were singing together, right? Then he he says this in verse 3, declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples. Now, I loved what we did earlier. In fact, our worship is one of the things I look forward to the most when we gather on Sunday mornings. I love Sunday. It's not just simply my favorite day because I'm a pastor. I just love coming together with God's people. I love seeing God's people, talking with God's people. I love praying with people in the foyer. I love worshiping together. I love hearing people read scripture. I love it when we pray corporately together. I love it when I see individuals praying together in ones or twos or threes and fours. I love the activities that I see take place on Sunday morning. But anything that we did today, we have not yet done what's being described in verse 3, and that's to declare his glory among the nations, right? Now, there can be non-believers who come in, and we're very glad when that happens, but the concept behind verse 3 is we need to go to where the nations are, to where the goyim, that's the Hebrew word kind of behind that. It's the non-Jewish people, to put that in the Old Testament context. We would say the non-believers, to go wherever they are, right? We have a lot of them in Jackson. I'm not just talking about the internationals. I'm talking about non-believers. We have a lot of them in different countries. Wherever they are, we go out among them and we declare his glory. And evangelism people and missions people, those who have been supernaturally gifted by the Holy Spirit with those gifts, remind us that God's glory is worth declaring. It's huge. And guys, at the end of the day, that's the most important thing. Yes, salvation, a non-believer coming to faith in Jesus is exciting. We want to see that happen. It's the very heartbeat of our triune God, right? Old Testament, Exodus 19. New Testament, 1 Peter chapter 2. The Great Commission of Matthew 28. Mark 16, 15. We see those passages that illustrate the heartbeat of our God is non-believers coming to faith in him. But there's something even better. And I want to be careful when I say that, because when I talk about this better thing, it's not like we can get rid of this activity, because this activity is the heartbeat of our God. But the even better thing is when one single believer declares to another human being that our God is glorious and awesome and worthy of all praise. That is even better. Now that is accomplished, that declaration of God's glory is accomplished when more and more people come to faith in Jesus and more people are declaring his praise. I think it's John Piper, pastor and theologian, says this, missions exists where worship does not. In other words, the whole reason for mission, the whole reason for evangelism is because there are still places where people are not declaring the worth of God. And until Christ returns or every single human being is converted, there will be missions and there will be evangelism because there is a God whose glory is worth declaring, right? Now, there's some inherent dangers. And just you can read those. There's a potential lack of depth. And we need to be very careful here because I'm not saying missions people or evangelism people lack depth. I'm just saying they can become so focused on the simple message of the gospel that sometimes they don't always leave room for some of the deeper teachings of God's word that are absolutely necessary. This is where knowledge people can come in and be really handy. This is where teaching people can come in and be really handy. They can become very isolated. This is just the nature of the task. And in some sense, this is part of the gift because they kind of got this go-it-alone personality. The evangelist does not need you in their life to share their faith. The missionary doesn't really need you in terms of being right next to them, babysitting them to share their faith with people. They just have it in them. They are go-it-alone self-starters, self-motivators. But that isolation can open them up to dangers of becoming discouraged or otherwise being cut off from the benefit of the other spiritual gifts, for example, wisdom and teaching, maybe some of the administrative gifts as well. And so you have the inserts that are there for you. You can kind of break that down and learn a little bit more about each of the spiritual gifts. But let me just kind of close it with this. If you've been kind of wondering over the last few weeks where your gift is, if you have that bifold insert, each week, and so the last 2 weeks we've done this as well, this is now the third installment of that. At the very end of that, the very back of that, the back page, we have this section called How Can You Discover Your Spiritual Gifts? Now we're on tip number three, or part three. And go back to the previous weeks, get a copy of it from the office. I think these things are online now. To see some of the other things. We're trying to give you every single week some tools that you can use in your daily life to be able to try to discover what God's will for you might be. So here is a spiritual gifts test. If you're a smartphone person, if not, you probably should be. But if this is where we are. But just grab that. There's an app for that, right? There actually is. There's an app for this. There are spiritual gift tests as well that we can provide to you if you want to take those things. Not the best way of discovering your spiritual gift, but it is a very helpful tool to be able to use. Usually what's involved there is you answer a series of questions just about what excites you, what you're good at, what you like to do, and that usually points you in a direction. It points you in a direction to what your spiritual gift be. If you're here this morning and you think you might be an evangelism-minded or missions-minded church, here's my request to you. Be bold. Don't stop. Don't be quiet. Don't shut up. Keep being our cheerleader. Keep motivating. Keep driving the leadership. Keep driving this church body to the one thing that excites you and the thing that needs to increasingly excite us, that we have the glorious privilege of sharing with the lost people that we know that Jesus loves them so much that he died to save them. Would you pray with me? Father God, you are good. And you have given us, Lord, not only your truth, not only teachers and those with discernment, those with the gift of knowledge, Lord, those among us, all the people who have wisdom, what a blessing they are. But Lord, you have given us motivators and cheerleaders. You have given us people that will not let us forget that the mission that you've given us, the very heartbeat, Lord, that drives you as our God, is to see non-believers come to faith in Jesus. I just pray that we listen. I just pray that we continue to get excited, Lord, as they cheer us on to do more and more. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.